Welcome to Gator Rituals, part three. I think it's three. I know it's definitely not two. It's probably three. This is the splinter segment of the main Running Out the Clock podcast. My Gator Rituals specifically, that's a tough word, talks about the University of Florida Gators and their football program. Jumping right in, we are over halfway with the season, halfway through with the season, with the 2018 season, and it's been a bit of a crazy one so far. Right now, Florida sits at 6-1, coming off their bye week, their last game against Vanderbilt, which was a really, really bizarre game. We talked about that a little bit in the main Running Out the Clock podcast a couple of weeks ago. I want to kind of jump in and talk a little bit about kind of what happened before moving on. Going into that game, I think everybody knew that it was going to be a little bit weird. It's anytime a game is played in that stadium, it's weird. It doesn't matter when, what time of day, who's playing. It's always a bizarre game. We had talked about it in the main podcast for that week, just how weird of a stadium that is, and how it just, you know, I think it only sits a hair less than 40,000 people. Joseph has actually been to the stadium, and he made a comment about just how bizarre the construction of that stadium is, and I'm sure that kind of plays a little bit into the overall feel of whatever's being performed there, whether it's a football game or a concert or, just a bunch of people fighting on the field for no reason. It seems like something that would happen there. The Florida Vanderbilt game 2 weeks ago, now with a score of a final of 37-27, and a game in which I think the total yardage for Florida was almost 600 total yards, 576 yards. They got 31 first downs, had a time of possession of 36 minutes, 14 seconds, almost 300 yards rushing, 284 yards through the air. And if you see that, sure, the 37 points make sense. You might think, wow, you probably should have scored closer to 50. The confusing part is that you gave up 27. Part of that, of course, was due to Keyshawn Vaughn, who had almost 150 yards just himself in the first quarter of the game before he went out with what looked like a head injury off of a running play down towards his own end zone. So that's really unfortunate for him, unfortunate for Vanderbilt in that game. They jumped out to a big lead, capitalizing off of Florida miscues and turnovers. I wouldn't say that Florida struggled early. They drove the field on their opening drive. Franks threw an interception basically on the goal line, but it wasn't necessarily a bad read. It was just that one of Vandy's defensive linemen kind of dropped back a little bit at the last second, and Franks put it off his helmet. With that, what are you going to do? You just take your time. you regroup, and you go back out there. And something that I mentioned last week was that something that this Florida team that they has this year that they haven't had in the last several years is a resiliency and a willingness to finish the game. And I'm sure that a lot of that is something that has been instilled in them by their head coach, Dan Mullen, something that they've really bought into. And of course, Dan Mullen being there helps because he's called several really good games this year, especially in their bigger games. Most notably, Mississippi State and LSU. He had good game plans. Florida executed it as well as they possibly could have, and they won those games. And so this is a game in which they kind of come off of two really big emotional wins. And so you think to yourself, well, maybe this is a trap game. And it sure kind of felt that way early because Florida turned the ball over, I think, four or five times, one of which was that weird yakety sacks sort of play where Franks has a quarterback keeper off the left edge and gets hit awkwardly, ball comes out, and then they basically stumble and fumble and kick over the ball for 30 to 35 yards the other direction before Vanderbilt fully recovers the ball. And so Florida manages to get some points right before halftime. LaMichael Perine comes up big right before half, getting a touchdown. He had a huge day, period. I want to say that as I pull up the stats here, Perine had something like 120 yards rushing. 121 total yards rushing on 23 attempts, and then 93 yards receiving on four catches. So he had 110 yards or so, just or 210 yards rather, total offense by himself. Pretty good, I guess, if you want to say that. Really showing that he wants a larger slice of the pie. Not that Jordan Scarlett's been bad. He himself had 113 yards rushing that game. But Perine is clearly separating himself. So if that's your 1-2 punch at Florida is Michael Perine and Jordan Scarlett, then you're doing pretty good given the output that they've had this year so far. And something that kind of muddied the water a little bit in that game was right before half, of course, you had the ugliness on the Florida sideline. Clearly a bad play by whoever was on the kick return team. Really nasty blindside block. Hit the guy in the head. Just an ugly play, something that honestly has no business being in the game. It's something that the NCAA is working hard to take out of the game. And so as much as I dislike the organization, good on them for trying to keep their players alive past the age of 30. So with all that aside, with Georgia or Florida generally playing well, but kind of shooting themselves in the foot with these turnovers, again, they show a willingness not to give up, to dig deep, and to come back on the road against Vanderbilt, who has given them some trouble over the last 5 or 6 years, and they pull out the victory. So Florida then last week heads into a bye week, having won five straight, four of which were SEC games. So they sit at 6-1 overall, 4-1 in the SEC with wins over Tennessee, Mississippi State, LSU, and Vanderbilt. So they go into the bye week last week, and they come out of it with their huge matchup against Georgia. Something that I think Florida fans thought would be a big game, if nothing else, that it's just a traditional rivalry game. It's neutral site in Jacksonville, the world's largest outdoor cocktail party. This year, really for the first time, I think the stat was for like the first time since 2012, both teams are ranked in the top 10. So a lot of people looking forward to this game. We spoke a little bit about what Florida needs to do. I'm being distracted by Baron the Magnificent over here playing with a toy for no reason. He hasn't been doing anything all day, and as soon as I sit down to record, of course, he decides now is the best time to find a squeaky toy and come right up to the mic and start biting it. So I do apologize for his interference. But so now it seems like as good a time as any to sort of bring up where Florida stands this year in relation to where they were at this point last year. Of course, at this point last year, famously or infamously, however you want to ascribe it, Jim McElwain had a weird week overall. Florida was 3-3, haven't had a great start. There were some questions about, I guess, McElwain's commitment to the program. So Florida-Georgia week, for those outside of the SEC or outside of the realm of Florida football and Georgia football, is a huge week. If it weren't for Florida State, Georgia would be Florida's biggest rival. So it's a fun week for the students. It's a fun week for the players. It's a fun week for the coaches to kind of, you know, start up the trash talk. And traditionally, Florida-Georgia has been the deciding game for who wins the East and represents the East in Atlanta. It hadn't been that way the last several years because Florida's been down. But it's a big week, and it should be something that is enjoyed by everybody. But last year, Jim McElwain essentially said that he and his players were receiving death threats from fans, which was weird. Nobody ever heard anything like that. There was no reports about it earlier. You know, he just randomly said, here's what's happening. We're getting death threats. So the school looks into it, you know, because the school has an obligation to protect its players and its staff and faculty members from threats. And so McElwain refused to offer any additional info or details about the threats. And nobody else could either, because essentially they didn't happen. So the university was looking into it further, and then game day comes around, and there's rumors on Twitter, on different parts of the internet, basically saying that it looked like Florida was looking for a way to fire Jim McElwain with cause. Just a really, really weird week. Some of the players this week were interviewed about what was going on at this point last year, and they were saying, you know, kind of the same thing, that it's just, that it's really bizarre. They wake up Saturday morning and start going through their pregame, and they're checking Twitter and seeing that their coach might get fired. And so, unsurprisingly, Florida takes the field, and Georgia immediately jumps out to a 21-0 lead within the first half of the first quarter. and never really recovered. And Jim McElwain was indeed fired directly after the game. So coming out of Florida-Georgia week, Florida was 3-4 and would only go on to win one more game the rest of the year. So here we are, it's 2018. Jim McElwain and his shark days are long gone. The Dan Mullen era looks to have started very successfully. 4-6-1 again going into Florida, Georgia. They're ranked number 9 in the nation, with Georgia, I think, being number 7. I spoke about kind of the keys to the game on this week's Running Out the Clock main podcast. So if you want to jump back over to that and check that out, please feel free to do that. Big week for Georgia, big week for Florida. Looks like the Florida rebuild might be a little bit further along. And of course, Dan Mullen can just sort of sit back and say, look at what we have here. It's essentially the same team as last year. And players are taking major steps forward. Past that 4-8 season, already winning two more games against, teams that they were not supposed to beat at all. Dan Mullen can definitely use that as a recruiting tool, and I'm sure he has. There's going to be recruits at the Florida-Georgia game for sure. They've set themselves up nicely here going forward. Saturday is going to be a big day for them. Saturday is going to be a big day for the recruits that are maybe on the fence about which school to go to. Saturday is going to be a lot of fun. We'll see what happens. Florida, thankfully, being far removed from the drama of the Jim McElwain era. And the confusion of the Will Muschamp era. That'll do it for this week's Gator Rituals. Tune in Monday for Week 9's recap, Running Out the Clock, and a look ahead to Week 10. And of course, we'll be back next week with Gator Rituals. And of course, be sure to check out Chandler Rollins, Okay, I've Got Some Thoughts, and then Joseph and Rose weekly pessimist podcast that they have about Mississippi State. You guys have a great week, have a great weekend, and we'll see you next week.